Welcome everybody, you're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. Today we're parsing some extremely nested JSON objects using Python. I would like to say thank you to those who have been watching and subscribing lately. I greatly appreciate it. So I decided let's use some tweets and figure out if we could parse these. So you have quite a bit of columns. If you just notice me scrolling over, goes over quite far. Today, this is what we're going to look at. It doesn't look like much until you start opening it up. It'd be this retweeted status. So if we could get through this today, you shouldn't be scared of really any other JSON objects, hopefully. So what I decided to do here is say, if I'm finding a tweet that was not retweeted, what I would like to do is say, if it was Nan, replace it with a nothing retweeted. Otherwise, just append the rest of your data. And that's what you have here. Now, here's something that's really interesting. This whole thing that you're looking at, which is just lines and lines of nested upon nested data. You have entities, which have inside of it URL, which has inside of that URLs, which has inside of that a list of more URLs. And you say, oh my God, how am I going to start dealing with this? But that's not it. Keeps going and going. Some of these are hundreds of key value pairs for one entry. Okay, so what we need to do is recursively call our function to go inside our nested object. Now, what you have to realize are a few things. When you're recursively calling, you can take only the outer or only the inner keys if you would like. But for me, I would like to take every single key and create a outer to inner separated by a dot notation so we can get an idea. Then to keep track of our keys, I'm going to use label indexing. Then, like I said, the dot notation and finally take care of non-retweets. This function I found online, I got a link in the description, and I modified it just slightly. But what you're doing is you're first looking to see if you have a dictionary. If you have that dictionary, you're iterating between your key value pairs, and you're formatting where you're taking your keys and you're getting your index that you're finding here. You're making a recursive call, going inside of it, and if you find a list inside, then you iterate through that list, and then, let's do this. Let me show you what happens so you get an idea of what is what. See how it just spaced these out? Let's do this again. So you're affecting these right here. If I did a dot right here, now let's do a semicolon. You see how it's adding that semicolon? That's what you're affecting. So in essence, what I needed to do is say, let me create an index so then I could keep track of everything. And here I have the index separated by a dot and then my key, my index separated by a dot. But then you notice here's where I have my nested keys. So what we have to do after we take this is we need to separate these keys and our values, okay? So if you notice, this is my value, this is my key, this is my index. So let's separate that index. I'm creating two empty lists. One will store my key, one will store my value, as well as the index for each. I iterate through what I just created above, but I'm splitting by the dot. So I'm taking the first instance of it, which will be this. That's your first instance. So then you end up with your index for your keys. Then I'm creating the values where I'm separating on the first one again with different notation, and then I'm taking my value, which will be this inside of that list. Then I save those, and this notation here corresponds to what position it is in my return statement. And here's what you end up with. So for my index with a key, if you notice that there's an index, but there is not a key with it, it meant that it was not retweeted, okay? So that's what's going on with this. Then we have our key here with our value here. So I showed an iteration of what we're going to do next. You're basically going to take all of your indexes that are separated from their keys, and what you're going to do is create a dictionary where you have your key and all the values are a list. So you go in and create a new function that's taking my items and I'm iterating through, and I have to use this minus one, so you're going to the end. but you will have a range issue when you're doing this. That's why the minus one. And what I'm doing is I'm comparing basically this one to the next one, making sure they're same, and then appending them. So that's what you have here. But then if you notice, you do not have the 0, 0, which was the non-retweet. That's because it doesn't have one that corresponds to the next one, because it was isolated by itself. But that's okay, we take care of that later, all right? So you do your comparisons, and then you append it with the key and the value. And I did this here because when I was looking at them, I had it set up in a different notation, and it was separated by spaces, or you can separate your key differently here, like this, and like this. See how everything's separated here? And that's how I had it set it up initially, and that's what I changed now. So let's go back. So now we have everything that's per key with each list of values, but now we have to do something a little different to take care of this. So what do we have to do for parsing? Well, to use this function that I created, tweetValParse, I am creating the key value pairs with two separate lists, which will be the tweet and the no tweet that we're iterating through. Okay, so here I'm creating my default dictionary. That's the same as what you saw above. It's this right here, put into a function. Then here we're creating a new default list, but we're taking care of the no retweets this time, and we're going to create a dictionary of these. And if it actually has a retweet, then that's what's going on here. And here's your two lists that you're actually here's the two lists that you're actually performing. Then I printed out here one specific example so you can see what it looks like. All right, so here's your values, here's your specific key value pairs that were not associated. From there, I needed to look into something that was interesting. When you're evaluating your key value pairs where your values are a list, not every value has the same keys. That's what this is designating here. You need to take care of that because that's going to depend on how you set everything up. If you did a list of only the unique values of keys and you iterated through, you need to make a provision to put a null value or a zero or whatever when you don't have a key coming up. So just pay attention to that. That's why I did this right here, so you can get an idea. Also, one thing to consider when you're dealing with these data, since you have hundreds of possible key value pairs for each individual entry, you should probably consider doing an iterator, like a yield statement in your function, and then reiterate through after the fact, so you're preserving your memory. The other thing is when you're recreating an extended data frame with the new columns, I would also say you should put your non-retweeted key value pairs in as well, because that's easy to forget. So here's a proof of concept that I took with two specific entries from number one. It says 10, but the second zero is the second index position. And what I did was I zipped them together so I can create the key as well as the value to see if I could get this to work. And it does work. So I took the index vals from above with the function that we made, and then this was aliased from another function that we had above. Now we can look at our key value pairs and figure out what we can do. So if you notice this, we have a nested list that has all of our tuples that are our key value pairs. Okay, but you don't have your retweets or your non-retweets. So you need to take care of that. Let's move to the next part where we need to grab the indexes so we can start working with these data. So above I had that function that I was going to use, but it was stored as a dictionary. So I'm just using this as the tuples, so I don't have to do any further formatting. Where I just took the original data frame, and from there I just converted the spotlight has a NaN value to a nothing retweeted, and then the second indice that we need right here, and then just called the actual iterator as a string so it shows up like this since it was an integer. Now this will let me go back and work with our data to append to these specific locations. So if we need to add the entries for the correct index, how would we do this? Well, it's not as bad as you would think. So I have two lists of tuples, And I say, well, instead of iterating, let's just append it to the end, and then we will sort by key so it all makes sense. And that's simple. So then what I did is I zipped together my keys and my values from the retweet, and then I took the no retweet and I extended it in so it would not create any list of lists further. And you could see that it appended it here to the very end. From there, I sort by key, and this is very simple. You just sort the tuples by the key, which is the first entry here, and you print that off. And here's what you have. So you say, okay, did that really work out? Well, yes, it did. Because now you have your first entry, which was nothing retweeted. Then you have your second entry. Now, I took 50 specific entries. And we can look at that real quick to verify that this is 50. So you can see down here, 49th, but it starts at zero index. So we do indeed have 50. But if you pay attention, I still have on purpose my index position. And then this is still a list of key value pairs as tuples. But I leave that for the end user to do whatever they want if they're inclined. My purpose today was to show you that we can take, let me go back to the top, highly nested, horrific data, such as this, iterate and maintain every key value pair. All right? That was the purpose of this ingenious method that I found online as well. And that's the great thing about Stack Overflow sometimes if you know what you're searching for. But I felt that this was a great video for those who were interested. If you would like to see two of my other videos related to creating JSON functions or parsing files, feel free and look at the card above. As always, I would like to say thank you for watching. I hope this brought utility to somebody. Don't forget to like and subscribe. And if you subscribe, turn on that notification bell. See you in the next video. Bye.